Okay, so among next viral disease of birds, today we'll learn about Marek's disease. So Marek's disease is a viral disease, as well as this disease is also comes under neoplastic disease, because this particular virus are responsible for development of tumors in birds. So originally, this particular Marek's disease was described in 19th century by Hungarian pathologist Joseph Marek, and initially the term which is coined by Dr. Marek was polyneuritis. And slowly and slowly, in later in work, other scientists given the name Marek's, because this particular scientist have done tremendous job for characterization of this disease. So later in 19th century, other scientists given this name Marek's disease. There are other synonym also for this disease. This includes neuritis, neurolymphomatosis gallinarum, and rank paralysis. So Marek's disease is a lymphoproliferative and neuropathic disease of domestic chickens caused by highly contagious cell-associated. This is another important thing, cell-associated. It means this virus will remain inside the cells, and oncogenic means they are responsible for development of tumors, herpes virus. And this particular disease is characterized by infiltration of neoplastic cells in various tissue. They are responsible for development of tumors or neoplasm in many tissue of the body, as well as there will be also infiltration of neoplastic cells into the iris and skin. Initially, it was a whitelisted disease, but nowadays they are not in the list of OIE, World Organization for Animal Health. Now, etiology. So, etiology of this Marek's disease is a Marek's disease virus, and this is Gallid herpes virus 2, serotype 1. Right? So, Marek's disease is caused by Gallid herpes virus 2, serotype 1, and this belongs to genus Mardivirus, subfamily Arpa herpes virinae, and family herpes viridae. So, within this genus Mardivirus, there are closely related but distinct species of viruses are grouped together. And this includes what you have first learned, serotype 1, and this is nothing but this is Gallid herpes virus 2, which is responsible for Marek's disease. The second one is serotype 2, and this is Gallid herpes virus type 3. Right? Please do not make any confusions between the serotypes and herpes virus. Right? Serotype 1 is herpes virus 2, and they are responsible for Marek's disease. And this is the only serotype, or herpes virus 2 is the only virus which are oncogenic, and other what we will discuss now, they are actually non-oncogenic, so they are not responsible for development of tumors. Right? So serotype 2 is a non-oncogenic, and they are actually Gallid herpes virus type 3, and serotype 3 is a herpes virus of Turkey, and they are also non-oncogenic. Right? So serotype 2 and 3 are actually non-oncogenic. Serotype 1, Gallid herpes virus 2, is only oncogenic viruses which are responsible for development of tumors in birds. Now pathotypes. This particularly MD virus or Gallid herpes virus 2, serotype 1, they are again divided into various pathotype. You can see here. Right? So these are the pathotype of Marek's disease, and depending upon their pathogenicity, depending upon their virulency, this particularly Gallid herpes virus 2 is again divided into different pathotype. This includes mild Marek's disease virus, right? And the abbreviation will be small m MDV. Okay, then virulent MDV, then very virulent MDV, and very virulent plus MDV. Right? So you can see here, these are the abbreviations which is used for describe the various pathotype of this Gallid herpes virus 2. And you can see definitely this mild Meniscus virus, they are comparatively to produce milder lesions and generally very virulent, plus MDV virus strain are responsible for very severe lesions, and generally they are responsible for severe apoptosis of the lymphoid cells in thymus and Purkinje, and they are responsible for severe atrophy, and many times it will induce very early mortality. So this particular outcome of this disease will also depend upon the various pathotypes. Here you can see this is a some beautiful picture taken from Cornell University website for education purpose only, and majority of these gross pictures and macroscopic pictures are taken from Cornell University website. So here you can see this is the difference between the various strain of this MDV virus, and this is, you can see this is control animals, control chicks, right? So you, here you can see these are the different lobe of the thymuses. This one is Burkinje and this is a spleen. So you can compare, this is thymus, this all are thymuses, right? This is Burkinje and this is spleen. So you can compare the virulency of this MDV virus strain. In case of virulent strain, when we go downward side, when virulence increases, ultimately they are responsible for severe atrophy of the thymus as well as Burkinje, right? So generally very virulent plus strains are responsible for severe atrophy of the thymus and Burkinje, and ultimately to induce very severe immunosuppressions, and many a time they are also responsible for induction of early mortality, or you can say early mortality syndrome, right? So generally in comparatively virulent strain or very virulent strain, they are also responsible for atrophy, but when you compare this pathogenicity or severity, generally this very virulent plus strain are responsible for very severe atrophy of the thymus and Burkinje. Now host, so domestic chickens are actually prime target for this disease. And this domestic chickens are ubiquitous, this particular disease is ubiquitous among the poultry population throughout the world. Occasionally the disease occurs in turkeys and quail, but generally this is rare in other species, right? So mainly these domestic chickens are prime target for this virus. Now transmission. Only horizontal transmission is reported. Till today there is no any reports of vertical transmission, right? And most importantly, this feathered follicular epithelial cells, right? Feathered follicle epithelial cells are mainly responsible for transmission of this disease, right? What we have discussed earlier, this Marek disease are generally cell associated virus, right? So generally they will remain inside the cell, and in other part of the body, generally this particular virus will replicate, but they are actually productive restricted, right? So generally there will be not fully infected virions are produced inside the other part of the body, but in feather follicle epithelium, here there is only fully replication of this virus is possible. And in this particular case, this particular virus or virus, when this virus will replicate in feather follicle epithelial cells, ultimately it will produce fully formed virions which are able to infect other birds, right? So this particular feather follicle epithelium is a main source of infection for other epithelium. So here what happened, when this virus will get replicated inside the feather follicle epithelial cells, ultimately it will induce to apoptosis, and this particular cells will get sloughed into the surrounding environment, and ultimately they will mix with the surrounding environment, and they become source of infection for other healthy birds. And during the bird's movement, generally this particular feather, from this feather follicle epithelial cells, which is actually already get sloughed, they are get from the feather epithelial cells, and they are get mixed with the environment. So during movement, this particular virus will get mixed with the air, and it will reach into the respiratory tract of the birds, and ultimately they will produce the disease. Then apart from that, actually some darkening beetles are responsible for transmission of this Varroa disease, and there are some reports that darkening beetles, here you can see these darkening beetles can be responsible for transmission of this disease. But otherwise, these feeder follicle epithelial cells are only responsible for transmission of this disease, because in only this this epithelial cells, this virus can able to replicate fully, and cell-free virus can only seen in this dendrite or this particular cells only, and due to this reason there will be transmission of this disease possible. Now pathogenesis. So pathogenesis, for easy understanding, the pathogenesis are divided into four different phases, right? But this is again, this is for just for understanding only. The first phase is early productive restrictive infection phase. Second one is latent infection phase. Third one is a second productive restrictive infection phase. And fourth one is proliferative phase or development of lymphoma. Right? So pathogenesis of this virus are depend upon so many factors, including strain of the virus. Suppose if this is very virulent strain of very virulent plus strain of the Marek disease, in that case birds will die in this particular phase, or there will be very rapid production of a lymphoma, right? So this is just for understanding purpose only. You will not find such a typical typical dividation of the development of the disease. So first we will discuss early productive restrictive phase. So this early productive restrictive phase, in this particular phase here, what happened? The infection is productive restrictive because the virus will remain cell associated and is only transferred by cell to cell contact, right? So, and this is the reason why we used productive restrictive, because there are some restrictions, cell are able to move from cell to cell only. So here what happened, we have already discussed this virus, this particularly Marek disease virus can fully replicate only in feeder follicle epithelial cells. So initially this particular virus will replicate inside the this particular cells, and slowly and slowly such infected cells will get sloughed into the environment, and they become source of infection for other healthy birds. So it will get it will mixed with the air, so there will be some formation of aerosols, and these aerosols are get inhaled by healthy birds. So through this aerosol route, ultimately this particular virus will enter into the body. It will go into the respiratory tract, and inside the respiratory tract, this particular virus are probably taken up by macrophages, right? So initially this particular virus will taken up by macrophages, and through this infected macrophages, it will spread into the different lymphoid organs like spleen, bursa and thymus. And inside these lymphoid organs, this particular virus will infect B lymphocytes. In particular first phase, it will infect B lymphocytes as well as activated T lymphocytes. And this includes mostly CD4 plus cells, as well it may also infect CD4 8 cells also. But most commonly it will infect B lymphocytes and CD4 T lymphocytes. Generally this resting T lymphocytes are generally resistant to infections, they are generally not get infected, right? So here what happened, this particular virus will infect B lymphocytes and activated T lymphocytes, and it will replicate inside the such cells, and ultimately during the replication, due to the cytolytic effect, ultimately there will be it will induce apoptosis of B lymphocytes and T lymphocytes, and due to this apoptosis, what you will find, you will find severe atrophy of bursa and thymus, right? So you will find depending upon the strain of the viruses, you will find different severity, right? So in case of very virulent plus strain of MDV virus, you will find severe atrophy of the thymus and bursa, and many a time it will lead to death of the bird. So there will be no further development of the disease. But in some milder form, there will be initially you will find some atrophy of the thymus and bursa, and this will lead to temporary immunosuppression, right? So this is first stage. Now after 6 to 7 days, generally there will be the development of some immunity, and as well as due to development of immunity, this particular virus become latent, right? So here what happened, this infected T lymphocytes, inside the infected T lymphocytes, this particular virus will spread throughout the body. And here also there will be latency. It means virus will present inside the infected T lymphocyte, but it will not respond. So there will be no any transcriptions or translation of the viral protein, right? So viral genomes are present inside the infected lymphocytes, but there will be no any transcriptions or viral proteins are synthesized, and ultimately, and this particular phenomenon is known as latency, right? So latency is nothing but when viral genomes are present inside the infected cells, but there is no any transcription or no any viral proteins are synthesized, right? So this is known as latency. So generally here what happen, just after first phase the latency will be developed probably after 6 to 7 days of post infections, and through this infected T lymphocyte virus will again spread into most of these lymphoid organs. Then it will reach to the third phase, and this is known as second operative restrictive phase. So here this infected T lymphocytes, particularly latently infected T lymphocytes, will spread this particular virus into the various organs like spleen, bursa and thymus, and now again there will be reactivation of the virus, will the virus will replicate inside the such cells, and ultimately it will produce severe apoptosis of the lymphocytes, and due to severe apoptosis ultimately this will lead to permanent immunosuppression. Here the another important thing is in this particular third stage, here what happened, this infected lymphocyte will also reach into the skin, and inside the skin this particular infected lymphocyte will get aggregated into the tips of feather follicles, and now they will infect the feather follicular epithelial cells, right? So here through this infected lymphocyte virus will enter into the feather follicle epithelial cells, and as we have already discussed, these feather follicle epithelial cells are only known site for complete virus replication. So here virus will replicate, and ultimately cell-free virus are produced, and this particular shed into the environment in a feather debris or dendrites, and ultimately you will find and this particular product are responsible, and they are become source of infection for other healthy birds. And in last phase, development of lymphoma phase, here what happened, this latently infected T lymphocytes, most commonly CD4 or occasional CD8 T lymphocytes, are subsequently transformed into neoplastic cells, right? And these particular neoplastic cells will infiltrate in various organs including nerves, lungs, liver, kidney, right, and many other organs, and ultimately it will produce lymphoma. So you will find variety of organs are infected with the they are infiltrated with this neoplastic lymphocytes, and ultimately slowly there will be development of lymphomas. Apart from development of lymphomas, there are some other lesions are also developed in this Marek's disease. First one is transient paralysis, right? So here what happened, this particularly infected lymphocyte will reach into the CNS tissue, and ultimately they will produce vasculitis, right? So due to this vasculitis, there will be increased vascular permeability, and there will be exudation of a plasma along with the plasma protein, and this will lead to vasogenic edema of the brain. And due to this vasogenic edema, you will find typical flaccid paralysis of the neck, and many times they are transient, means after 48 hours bird will slowly get recovered, but many a time this will also become fatal, because during this period they will unable to take any food or water, and sometimes this will lead to death of the birds. As well as in some cases there will be also development of atherosclerosis, right? Particularly large blood vessels, particularly smooth muscles of the blood vessels, where there will be accumulation of a lipid materials, right? And what is the actual pathogenesis for this particular development of atherosclerosis is still not completely elucidated. Now clinical signs. So generally clinical signs are most frequently seen between 12 to 24 weeks of age, and again these clinical signs are not characteristic for MD. You will find variety of clinical signs, they are not clearly indicative that these particular birds are showing clinical signs of Marek's disease. And for easy understanding, this clinical signs of Marek's disease are classified into four forms: classical form, acute form, acute cytolytic disease form, and transient paralysis form. Right. So in classic form, here what happened? You will find typical neural involvement here because the nerves are mainly affected because this probably this infected or transformed neoplastic cells are infiltrated in the various peripheral nerves of the body, and depending upon the which particular nerves are affected, you will find that particular that type of clinical signs. So generally here this mortality rate rarely exceeds 10 to 15%, and you will find partial or complete paralysis of the legs, wings or neck, or depending upon the which particular nerves are get affected. So if there is particularly nerves which are responsible for control of neck, if they are affected, then you will find torticollis. If nerves which of legs are affected, then you will find spastic paralysis of the leg. If wing nerves are affected, in that case you will find paralysis of the wings, right? So depending upon the which particular nerves are get affected, in that case you will find that type of typical lesions. In transient paralysis form, what we have already discussed is sometime here what happened. This particular infected lymphocyte will reach into the central nervous system. It will produce vasculitis, and due to this vasculitis, there will be exudation of a plasma as well as proteins from this blood, and ultimately they will accumulate it around the blood vessel. So this is known as vasogenic edema. Particularly in brain, there are two type of edema: cytotoxic edema and vasogenic edema. Vasogenic edema is due to particularly when these blood vessels become leaky. In that case, there will be accumulation fluid in perivascular tissue. This is known as vasogenic edema. And when these fluids are accumulated inside the cells, this is generally known as cytotoxic edema. Right. So here, due to vasogenic edema, the bird will show typical transient paralysis. Affected birds will suddenly develop varying degree of ataxia, incoordination movement, then paresis or paralysis. Generally, paresis means there will be paralysis are not permanent. This is temporary. Paralysis are generally temporary. When paralysis are temporary, then we can use the word paresis. If this paralysis is permanent, then if the paralytic form is permanent, then we have to use the word paralysis, right? So you will find either temporary or permanent paralysis of the legs, wings and neck. And in some cases, after 24 to 48 hours, many a time when this edema are actually get reabsorbed, fluid are get reabsorbed, in that case some birds are get reoccurred. And but in some cases this particular transient paralysis become fatal, because during this period there will be flaccid paralysis of different part of the body including neck, and birds will unable to take fluid, water as well as food. So ultimately this will lead to death of the birds. Here you can see this is typical paralysis, right? You can see this, there will be extension of the legs. Then another form is acute cytolytic disease form. So here what happens generally, this acute cytolytic disease form are generally seen in with the very virulent or very virulent plus MDV virus strain. And here this particular virus will induce a severe apoptosis of a B and T lymphocytes. So due to severe apoptosis of B and T lymphocytes, there will be atrophy of a lymphoid organs, and due to this reason there will be severe immunosuppression. This will lead to early mortality syndrome, and this is most commonly seen between 10 to 14 days of age. In acute form, you will find formation of lymphomas in visceral organ, but the clinical signs which is caused by this acute form are actually not typical to, or they are not actually indicative of this disease. They are quite variable. The birds will show either depression, weight loss, anorexia or diarrhea. Here you can see this is another picture showing typical spastic paralysis, right? So there are two types of paralysis: spastic paralysis and flaccid paralysis. Generally in case of flaccid paralysis, you can easily move that affected organs. They are comparatively very easily movable, right? But in spastic paralysis, it become very hard. So here you can see this is showing spastic paralysis of legs. And generally in case of MD, you will find spastic paralysis. But in transient paralysis, when these brains are affected due to vasogenic edema, in that case, you will find flaccid paralysis. Here you can see this is very typical clinical presentation of this Marek's disease. Here you can see this is the spastic paralysis of a leg, and in this case, due to unilateral non-involvement, one leg is affected and it will show typical spastic paralysis while another leg is completely normal. So you will find one is extended front and another will be remain in back. So this is very typical clinical presentation of a Marek's disease. Here, what we have discussed earlier, due to involvement of a nerves, due to severe infiltration of neoplastic lymphocytes into the nerves, which is comparatively that controls the neck movements. So due to paralysis, due to spastic paralysis, you will find typical torticollis. Here you can see this is twisting, this is opisthotonus. Due to typical opisthotonus are seen in birds. Backward extension of a head. Here you can see this is typical torticollis due to involvement of nerves which are responsible for control of the neck movement. So here you can see this is typical twisting of a neck, they are showing torticollis. Here also you can see this is birds are showing typical torticollis, and this all these cross pictures are taken from Cornell University website for education purpose only. Here you can see again this is paralysis of neck, and many times if vagus nerves are get affected, you will find very dilated crop. Okay, so here you can see this is a picture, they are showing typical transient paralysis, right? And they are responsible for flaccid neck paralysis, right? So due to vasculitis, there will be exudation of plasma and plasma protein into the brain, so there will be vasogenic edema, and due to this vasogenic edema, you will find typical neck paralysis. This is flaccid paralysis. Birds will unable to lift their neck, so there will be no movement, and many a time if they are extended for more than 48 hours, birds will unable to take feed and water, and there will be death of the birds. So many a time this transient paralysis become fatal. Here also you can see this typical paralysis. Here you can see this is particularly wings are affected, right? So here you can see unilateral wing paralysis, when generally the nerves which are responsible for wing movement, when they are get affected, you will find typical such type of wing paralysis. Here also you can see very typical presentation, one leg is extended, one is beneath the body part. So this is very typical presentation, one leg extended, most commonly seen in Marek's disease. And what you have discussed earlier, in some acute form you will find some typical non-specific clinical signs. Here you can see this bird are showing diarrhea. So this is comparative non-specific clinical signs, right? So generally specific, whenever you find some typical unilateral spastic paralysis, many a time they are indicative of this disease, but in some cases, in many time birds have a fully developed lymphomas in their bodies, but generally you will not find any type of clinical signs in birds, and sometimes some birds will get completely comatose and you will find very severe clinical signs, right? So clinical signs are quite variable in Marek's disease. Here you can see this is feather follicles, there are some ulceration over the skin, most of the feather follicles are get enlarged or there get somewhat raised due to epithelial hyperplasia as well as infiltration of lymphocytes. Now gross pathology. So grossly, again you will find variety of gross lesions, and for easy understanding they are again divided into, or again they are classified into classical forms or acute form or acute cytolytic disease. Okay, so generally classical forms, what you will find, there will be involvement of nerves as well as you will find typical lymphomas, right? So depending upon the which particular nerves are affected, you will find that type of typical lesions. So here what you will find typical enlargement of a one or more peripheral nerves, and when this particular, there will be severe infiltration of neoplastic lymphocytes into the peripheral nerves. In that case, nerves become severely enlarged, it may be thickened almost 2 to 3 times than normal, and due to severe infiltration of inflammatory cells inside the nerves, their normal cross striations as well as glistening appearance will be lost, and variety of nerve flexors and trunks are affected. Here you can see that they are least, as well as internal organs will show typical lymphomas, and generally ovaries, kidney, heart, livers and other tissue are get affected. So generally lymphoma are nothing but they are actually white blood cells tumor. So generally to white blood cell accumulation, that organs will show variable sized white foci to nodules, and they are nothing but aggregations of the neoplastic lymphocytes. Feeder follicles, we have already discussed that infected or neoplastic T lymphocytes will also get aggregated around the feeder follicles, and due to this you will find typical enlargement of the feeder follicles, and sometimes skin will show typical nodules. Then another term is gray eye, which is used to describe the eye lesions which is seen in Marek's disease. Here what happened, the neoplastic lymphocytes are infiltrated into the iris muscles or in iris. So here what happened, the normal color of the iris will all change, as well as the pupil diameter and pupil normal look of pupil will also get altered. In acute form, you will find mostly formation of lymphomas in various internal organs, and very very few nerves are get affected. In acute cytolytic disease, what we have already discussed, in particularly very virulent strain of the or very virulent plus strain of the Marek's disease, you will find because this particular strain of this virus is responsible for apoptosis of a TNB lymphocyte, and ultimately this will lead to atrophy of a thymus and bursa that we have already seen. Right. So here you can see this is feeder follicles, and they get enlarged because there will be epithelial hyperplasia as well as infiltration of a neoplastic lymphocytes. This is better picture. Here you can see this is feeder follicles. Right, and the surrounding epithelial cells are showing hyperplasia, so they are get raised. And here you can see this feeder follicle are severely infiltrated with the neoplastic epithelial cells. So you will find typical nodules in the skin. So this is very characteristic presentation. And here you can see this is comparatively normal eye. Here you can see this is iris, and this one is pupil. Right, so when you compare, this is compared normal, when you compare with the affected one, here you can see the normal diameter or normal size of pupil is again changed, and this is because this particular iris muscles are severely infiltrated with the neoplastic lymphocyte, so there will be change in the pupil size, and sometimes the when ample amount of lymphocytes are infiltrated in this iris, the color will also change, they become white in color. Here you can see this is nerves, right? So you can compare many a time this nerve involvements are unilateral, right? So here you can see this is affected one, this is compared normal one. So normal one shows some cross striation as well as some typical glistening appearance, while in this case you can see due to severe infiltration of a neoplastic neoplastic cells in the nerves, they become severely enlarged, almost 3 to 4 times than normal one. Right, so they get enlarged, then normal glistening appearance are lost, then normal cross striations are also lost, and affected part or the dependent part of this nerve will show paralysis when bird was live. Here you can see this is neck region, right? So this is neck, and this is vagus nerve. You can see this is vagus nerve, and this vagus nerve will show showing typical nodular enlargement, right? So here what happened, this because this neoplastic T lymphocytes are get infiltrated in this particular area, and due to severe accumulation of this neoplastic T lymphocytes, you will find such type of nodular enlargement of a vagus nerve. Here you can see this is again, you can compare these two, this one is comparatively healthy and these are the affected one. So when you compare the thickness or size of the nerve, this is almost 3 to 4 times than this one. Right, so they are get enlarged, normal striations are get lost, normal glistening appearance are get lost, as well as they are get enlarged, right? So due to infiltration of inflammatory cells, infiltration of neoplastic cells. Here you can see this is lung, right? And general lung should be red in color, but here what happened? They are showing large multifocal to coalescing nodules, right? So these nodules are nothing but this is lymphoma, right? And here what happened? These neoplastic lymphocytes are get severely infiltrated in the lungs, and because they are white blood cells, so you will find such type of white red foci in the white blood nodules over the lung. Here you can see the livers are showing white red foci, right? So these are again nothing but they are actually lymphoma. Here you can see the spleen are severely get enlarged, and due to severe infiltration of a neoplastic lymphocyte into the spleen, the entire normal spleen color is also changed. Normally it should be dark brown in color, but it become completely whitish in color due to excessive accumulation of neoplastic lymphocytes. Here you can see the ovaries, the follicles are also showing lymphoma. They are comparatively healthy ones, follicles. Here you can see this epicardial fat are also showing accumulation of neoplastic T lymphocytes, and whenever there is the accumulation of T lymphocytes in enough amount, it will be giving such type of whitish discoloration. Here you can see this is jejunum as well as mesentery. In both cases you will find such type of nodules, or the jejunum as well as mesentery are also showing such type of nodules, right? So this is lymphoma, accumulation of neoplastic lymphocytes. Now microscopic lesions. So microscopically, again, the all these organs which are affected grossly will show typical microscopic lesions, but particularly in case of nerves, these microscopic lesions are again classified into three types: type A, type B, and type C. Right? So type A, microscopically, particularly in the nerves, when they are affected with type A lesions, here what happened? The general type A lesions are characteristics of neoplastic lesions, and here you will find ample amount of infiltration of pleomorphic lymphoblastic cells and a smaller amount of lymphoblast as well as some lymphocytes, right? So here particularly in type A lesions you will find severe infiltration of neoplastic lymphocytes as well as lymphoblast, right? So there is severe infiltration of lymphoblast. In type B lesions, they are generally considered as a inflammatory type lesions, and here what you will find, some edema of the nerves. You will also find Schwann cell proliferations, as well as you will find infiltration of small lymphocyte as well as plasma cells. And in type C lesions, generally what you will find very little amount of infiltration of neoplastic lymphocytes. You will find lightly scattered lymphocytes and plasma cell infiltration, right? So depending upon the microscopic lesions, you can classify it the nerve lesions either type A, type B, or type C. When very few number of cells are present in cells, then we can say, okay, this is type C lesions. When you will find edema, Schwann cell proliferations, and mixture of cells, then we can say, okay, this is type B lesions. And when only neoplastic lymphoblasts and very few lymphocytes are present, we can say, okay, this is type A lesions. Then in case of brain, you will find perivascular coughing as well as gliosis. In particular, transient paralysis, when birds are get died, and if we go for microscopic examination, you will find typical vasculitis, and due to this vasculitis, you will find also perivascular edema, vasogenic edema. In visceral organs, you will find typical lymphoma that involved various organs like liver, lung, kidney, ovaries, and many other organs. And microscopically, what you will find? You will find diffuse infiltration of proliferating small to medium sized T lymphocyte, lymphoblast, NK cells, B cells, macrophages, and rarely plasma cells, right? So here what you have to remember, the important thing is, in particularly Marek's disease, there will be infiltration of neoplastic T lymphocyte, but along with that you will also find infiltration of various other cells like NK cells, B cells, macrophage, and rarely plasma cells. So generally what you will find, you will not find monotonous populations, you will find different cell population, and many times they are actually indicative of Marek's disease, because many a times this type of lymphoma should be differentiated from another important disease like lymphoid leukosis or disease caused by reticular endothelial viruses, right? So in that case, generally cell populations are monotonous. Generally you will find uniform populations, while in case of Marek's disease you will find variety of cells, including small to medium sized T lymphocytes, lymphoblasts, NK cells, B cells, macrophages, and rarely plasma cells, right? So due to mixture of all cells, you will find slightly pleomorphic appearance, slightly, and generally they are not monotonous. In case of eye, generally neoplastic cells are infiltrated in the iris muscles, so you will find infiltrations of neoplastic cells. In acute cytolytic disease, what we have discussed earlier, very virulent strain or very virulent plus strain of this MD virus are responsible for this acute cytolytic disease. And in this case, what you will find severe depletion of a lymphocyte from the bursa and thymus. Due to severe apoptosis, you will find a decreased cellularity from the thymus and bursa. And what we have discussed earlier, atherosclerosis. So generally in Marek's disease, in some surviving birds, you will find atherosclerosis. And why this atherosclerosis happens is still not completely elucidated, but the smooth muscles of the major arteries will show accumulation of lipid materials in the smooth muscle cells. And in some cases, we will also find atherosclerosis in blood vessels. So here you can see, this is microscopic picture of a nerve, right? And these particular nerves are showing infiltration of neoplastic lymphocytes, right? Here we are not able to find typical edema or other inflammatory cells or Schwann cell proliferations. Most of these cells are neoplastic lymphoblast, right, as well as lymphocytes. So this such type of lesions will be considered as a type A lesions in nerve. Here you can see, again, this is nerve, right? And here you can find some edema, right? So here you will able to find some edema, as well as there are infiltration of a small and medium sized lymphocytes, right? Here you can see some lymphocytes as well as some plasma cells, right? So here mixture of cells are get infiltrated along with edema. So this is just like some inflammatory lesions rather than neoplastic. So this type of lesions are considered as a type B lesions. And generally type C lesions, you will rarely find very few infiltration of lymphocyte cells. And here you can see, this is typical of lymphoma, and this is kidney. Here you can see some normal kidney tubules are visible. These all red cells are nothing but they are RBC. In birds, generally you will find nucleated RBC. So this is nucleus of the RBC, and here you can see this is lymphoma, right? So this is all neoplastic lymphoblast, as well as some small lymphocytes are visible, some mitotic figures, so they are multiplying cells. And generally we are talking that generally you will find pleomorphic cells in Marek's disease, but many a time, just falsely on basis of histopathology, you cannot identify either this is Marek's disease or this is lymphoid leukosis. Many times you have to go for identification of the cells. Generally in Marek's disease you will find T cell lymphoma, while in other like lymphoid leukosis you will find B cell lymphoma, right? So this is major difference. And by detection with the immunohistochemistry like CD3 or CD79A, you can say this is either T cell lymphoma or B cell lymphoma. Generally CD3 stain T cell, so whenever there is a T cell lymphoma, whenever there is Marek's disease lymphoma, CD3 will give positive reactions, while CD79A is a marker of B lymphocytes. And whenever you go for B immunohistochemistry for CD79A, if cells are positive, means they are B lymphocytes, and generally they are indicative of lymphoid leukosis. That we will see later on. So diagnosis based on the clinical science. Again, clinical science, sometime when you find unilateral paralysis of the wings or legs, sometimes they are indicative of this disease. But many a times clinical signs are not indicative of this disease. Gross lesions, generally enlargement of the nerves, are indicative of this disease, as well as whenever you find some lymphomas, they are also indicative of this disease, right? But if you will only find lymphoma, in that case you have to go for differential diagnosis with some other disease like lymphoid leukosis, right? So for confirmation, what type of sample you should collect? So first you collect buffy coat. and generally you should collect the buffercoat in heparinized vial, right? So generally in buffercoat contain infected lymphocytes. So we can, with the help of such lymphocyte, we can confirm okay the Marek's disease is present or not, as well as you can also collect the lymphoma, typical nodules which is present in the spleen or in any other organs. Generally they contain lymph cells which are infected, so we can confirm the disease, as well as some less commonly you can also collect the feather tips, right? Sometimes it contains cell free virus, and with the help of PCR or any other techniques we can confirm this disease. Serological tests like agar gel immunodiffusions, immunofluorescence or ELISA or PCR can be used for confirmation of this disease. Then another terminology that you should aware in whenever you learn about Marek's disease, this is Marek's disease associated tumor surface antigen, right? So this generally such type of tumor surface antigens are found in typical MD lymphomas. Initially it was thought that this is very peculiar for Marek's disease, but some recent research is saying that this particularly Marek's disease associated tumor surface antigen is not very specific for Marek's disease only. They are also found in B cell lymphoma as well as some other lymphocytes. So this is all about Marek's disease. Thank you for watching.